I'm Clare Milledge. I'm sitting here in my studio on unceded Garrigal land, and we're on a headland right next to Bangali headland. Growing up in the forest, I think my aesthetic is really connected to that. So the way things feed into each other or compost into each other or grow into each other, you know, when things don't have like nice edges or there's dirt on things or things are falling apart, I think that has really informed my process. We didn't have electricity. We were in a converted army tent, and my parents are environmental scientists. So everything that we did, you know, collecting seeds to help them or checking the mist nets to see what birds might have flown in, to see what was there. We always had like animals that were sort of, you know, needed rescuing or attention around the house. And so I think all of those things became part of the work. Almost all of my projects start with field work. The field work sort of is the beginning, but it also goes throughout the process as well. And that field work often is me following my parents around in the field, quite literally, and collecting data and material and little snippets of conversation and ideas and things like that that are specifically related to what they're doing. I tend to collect words and I collect them in the field work that I do. I collect them when I'm reading, I take notes. And when I collect those notes and words, I'm really interested in the way that words can convey multiple meanings and lead you on sort of different pathways, etc. But how words are important to us, and in particular with this installation, I think one thing that I've been a bit focused on is oral language. I've collected recordings in the field of my mother and her friend, and they've done ecological work in the Widjibal Weeable area, which is where I grew up on Bundjalung country. And they've done a lot of ecological work there, and they're having this kind of conversation, snippets of conversation, and all kinds of things like, oh, look at that rhyolite, you know, geological formation up there, and look how this tree is growing at an angle but the other one isn't, and, you know, very interesting kind of observations. And those observations and their discussions about like species names and things like that then are provided to Felicia Atkinson, and she is kind of taking those words and fragments and things and reworking it into something which is going to have a new form but still has like elements of the original words. And it was nice to hear what she was saying when we were discussing how she might put it together, that she's not going to, you know, just repeat everything that's there, but she takes the material and she takes it like she's picking flowers. So, you know, she's taking that's a really nice piece. And that's very similar to the way that I work. So the structure of the installation is that you go into the space at Pier 2-3. Inside that big space, we've got a footprint which is 6 metres by 12 metres, and we've got 4.5 metres high silk walls along that. So it's all hand-dyed from ahimsa silk, which is peace silk, which doesn't kill the silkworms. And then inside that space, inside that giant rectangle, we've got a wooden stage, which is built from old pallets, and it's tiered. And around that tiered space are the 9 cauldrons that will be suspended. And then around that are 7 big glass paintings, which are also suspended over the water. What's really important within that space is the sound. It has one central soundtrack, which is Felicia Atkinson is working on, and overlaid over that is a sound library, which is accessed in relation to the tidal depth of the harbour. So when Sydney Harbour is full, the samples in the sound library will be accessed more frequently. So the sound will build. And as when the tide is low, you won't hear anything except Felicia's track. So I really wanted to connect to the water quite directly like that.